Hi.
My name is Tzahi Oved from Mellanox Technologies, responsible for software architecture. So I would like to introduce our work developing verbs to better support user mode Ethernet and user mode applications that would like to implement user mode stacks or any Ethernet application. So I will start with an introduction. I'll present the current status, what we have today with the user mode Ethernet support. Then I'll continue with features we would like to add, like the RSS, the receive side scaling, how we think we should support L2 tunneling stateless offloads that are now being pushed in into hardware support in NICs for the network driver of the operating system. For debug and diag, we would like to show how actually we allow capturing of such OS bypass traffic. I would like to present some modifications or suggestions for modifications of completion queue, which is a critical data path object, and how we think we should expand it. Last but not least would be how we would like to allow a non-privileged access for user mode Ethernet. Currently it's only for privileged users, and the conclusion. So a quick introduction. We see that telecom, Web2O, cloud, and FSI customers, the financials and the algo trading customers are increasing network requirements. They would like to get higher packet per second. They would like to get very low latency, basically minimize the CPU utilizations and the cycles per byte they spent there. And it seems like we can't avoid the fact that the operating system adds a lot of overhead, and the OS bypass mechanisms are required. Also, another factor here is using standard protocols. We don't want to change the ecosystem and invent proprietary protocols. There is already existing rich hardware protocol offload support in the NICs for the operating system network driver. And also we would like to interoperate with any other applications that runs on legacy sockets APIs. So with current status, basically today we have the object IBV QP of type raw Ethernet. So basically applications can run today user mode Ethernet on top of verbs using the raw Ethernet QP type. It already uses the mature verbs objects that exist, QP, CQ, memory region. So basically, what is the raw QP? It's a pair, again, it's a queued pair, but for a send and receive work requests for Ethernet datagrams. So if you look at the illustration here, you can see that on the bottom part, we see the NIC. We have steering flow tables that can decide which traffic goes where and which traffic goes to this raw Ethernet QP. There's a stateless offload engine that mostly serving the network stack driver. You can see the raw QP. You can see the raw QP or something similar that is being used here for the network stack driver, and then the TCP/IP stack sockets and applications that run on this path can enjoy this stateless offload. So for raw QP in user land, we basically use it through the kernel verbs and user verbs and expose this raw QP. Again, you can send and receive Ethernet frames. You use the verb semantics, and basically you can run your own user mode stacks or even DPDK. We have a DPDK provider that uses the verbs underneath. Another Another issue here is the privileged user. So basically, because today a user that instantiates a raw Ethernet QP in userland can basically send whatever he wants, he builds the layer 2, the layer 3, the layer 4 headers, it must be a privileged user. And that's why only a user with the CAPNET raw privilege is allowed actually to create such a QP. Regarding stateless offloads, that's but not least is the what we support today through Verbs is the checksum offload and the interrupt moderation for the completion queue. Next slide is basically the new feature we would like to introduce, the receive side scaling and how we do that. So what is receive side scaling in a short slide? So it's a technology that allows us to spread the traffic load or processing of the incoming traffic load into multiple CPUs. We are doing that by utilizing multiple receive queues. So if in legacy mode we had the ingress traffic going into a receive queue, which is associated with a single completion queue, which is basically associated with a single CPU and interrupts a single CPU, with RSS, we can associate kind of an RSS hash mechanism to multiple receive queues. Each receive queue is associated with its own completion queue. And again, the completion queue is associated with the CPU. So basically, in such a way, we can distribute the load between multiple CPUs. So there is a spreading mechanism here that I will get into in next slide that has to do it in somewhat smart way, not present reordering of flow traffic between multiple CPUs and then processing them and ordering them in software. So basically what we see is that RSS is built of two basic operations. First, we classify, then we distribute. So what is the classify? So classify is basically you mention which type of flows goes where. For instance, we can classify that IPv4 traffic goes to a specific queue and IPv6 traffic goes to a different queue. And then we do the distribution. We can define different distributions for each classification. As I mentioned, so IPv4 can enjoy different classification, different distribution than IPv6, for instance. So basically, those are the two building blocks of RSS. So in terms of verbs, we use the existing IPv create flow to first classify incoming traffic. So basically, you can specify whatever attributes from the layer 2, layer 3, and layer 4 headers, and classify the traffic where the result would be a QP. Classify the traffic, so this type of traffic will get to a specific QP. And then we continue with spreading. So QP as the transport object will be now responsible for the spreading. Legacy QP could do it for a single RQ. What we propose here is that the new RSS QP will be able to do it for multiple RQs. So basically, a QP needs to carry a kind of an indirection table, which means that it actually associated with a table of receive queues. And as before, receive queues are associated with the completion queues, and that's how we basically spread the load. And the last bullet is what I mentioned. Different traffic types can be subject to different spreading. This is actually already a requirement from several operating systems. So such capability already exists with most NICs that allow RSS offload because they need to supply such a capability for the operating system network driver. So in terms of verbs, we actually would like to introduce a new object, a work queue. So basically, what is a work queue? If we look at a QP and maybe dissect a QP, we can see that a QP is built of kind of three main objects, a transport object, a send queue, and a receive wall queue, a send wall queue and a receive wall queue. Basically, the transport object is, you can look at it as an object that translates memory to wire or memory to a protocol. In terms of Ethernet, it can do MTU checks or enforcements. It can do VLAN checks and enforcements. And InfiniBand, it can represent the wire QP number. It can represent the queue key and things like that, things that are more related to the transport. And the send wall queue and receive wall queue is, are basically queues that you post, send, and receive work elements. So we propose basically to split those objects. So an verb IBV QP can be just the transport object, and we externalize the send and receive work request. We already have something very similar in verbs today with the IBV QP and Shrek. So basically, we can externalize the receive queue of the QP using existing shared receive queue, IBV SRQ. So besides externalizing them, we can now would like to introduce a way where we basically associate multiple such queues with a single transport object. Again, with RSS, for instance, we have basically a single transport and multiple queues. We don't need to have multiple transport objects. Those receive queues actually are subject to the same transport, same VLAN, same MTU. In terms of verbs, so basically whenever you use an IBV QP type of raw Ethernet, again, next will be to add also for UDQP such support for IP over IP. I will discuss this later. So for such raw Ethernet QP, we would like to introduce a new attribute, RX hash conf. So basically, this struct will describe the receive queue table parameters and the array of the receive queues. So the IBV work queue, that is the new element, can carry two types, a receive queue and a send queue. We'll start with the receive queue. Currently, we show how we use it for RSS. So we've built those four manipulation methods for allocating and manipulating the wall queue. You can see here what a wall queue basically carries. We basically took all the memory and the work queue attributes from the IBV QP and externalized them into the wall queue. Also, if you're familiar with the IBV Shrek, you can see that we also have a CQ here, which doesn't exist in the IBV Shrek, only in the XRC Shrek, if someone is familiar with that. Anyhow, so basically we can see here that such a work queue of type receive queue can be associated with a CQ and allow us to do the RSS operation. Also, of course, we can support many-to-one mapping. Many receive queues can use a single completion queue. So it's up to the user. Also, there's an option to actually share the memory. So the receive queue is basically a queue of a receive work request. We can share those work requests using SRQ. So basically, we can use the same memory for multiple receive queues. One use case can be if you have a NUMA node that is comprised of four CPUs but a single memory, you can basically allocate a single Shrek for all of them and only one buffer pool, but allow four queues for those four CPUs. Yes, that's it on this slide. This shows the state diagram of a receive work queue of type receive queue. Basically, we are familiar with the state diagram of the QP. For the receive work request, we basically have much simpler state diagram, a reset state where basically this is the initial state of the work request. The user can post receive buffers and prepare the work request before it actually being into use, then move it into ready, so the receive queue is ready to process incoming traffic. And an error when a user would like to destroy and deallocate his buffers. The indirection table is again a new structure that can be associated with a receive queue. And we can see here the methods that are used to manipulate the indirection table, create, modify, query, destroy. The indirection table is basically a separate object, so multiple QPs can be associated with the same indirection table. So if, for instance, if I go back to my example with IPv4 and IPv6 traffic, where we classify to different QPs, and then would like to distribute, we can basically use the same indirection table and the same receive queues for distributing the traffic, but we do it in a different way because the QP, the transport object, basically carries the distribution logic, the hash. So we can use different hashes for IPv4 and IPv6, but use the same queues and the indirection table for actually scattering the payload into memory. The RSS QP, it's basically the raw Ethernet QP, which is associated with indirection table. Such a QP is stateless. As mentioned, the send and receive work queues parameters that within the QP are invalid because now those are external, very similar to the relations of a QP, the existing relations of QP and Shrek. We don't use IBV post send post receive anymore. We use the post Wookie receive into the receive work request. And as mentioned, the QP is connected to the RQ indirection table. For receiving, we use the existing create flow. So we classify a specific kind of traffic to the QP. That's how the receive path flow. And following the steering to the QP, we actually choose the right receive queue through a hash calculation. And we can see here how we basically configure the hash calculation. So this is the RX hash conf structure that describes the hash. We can choose the hash function. Typically, it's tuplets. And which attributes from the layer 3 and 4 headers we would like to take into account when we calculate the hash. And also there's the hash key here. So very similar to what we have today with the OS driver, OS network, trivial OS network driver. This slide shows basically a diagram of the flow. So we can see here that we can start with the classification. Here we see that we classify IPv4 traffic into QP number 10 and IPv6 traffic into QP number 11. In the QP itself, we can see which fields we choose from IPv4 or from IPv6 to take into account when we calculate the receive hash. We have here the chosen receive hash function. The result would be the hash value. And according to the indirection table size, we take the LSB bits of the hash value and use them to point to the right entry in the indirection table. In the indirection table, we can see here that we have receive queue 5, 8, 4, and 5. We can use the same receive queue in multiple entries if we would like to play with the distribution if we would like to load balance, this is a dynamic table where users can modify on the fly the population of the receive queues in the indirection table. So basically they can balance the load if they can see that the current hash loads a specific CPU more than another. So they can play with it. And in this example, we can see that the receive queue 5 is associated with completion queue 1 and associated with core 1 and so on. So this is basically how the flow goes. So basically, so far, a bit about the status. We proposed the NRFC and patches to upstream. We are waiting for feedback and for working to get those accepted. And the next work we would like to continue with is supporting also UDQPs. UDQPs are used for IP over IB traffic, so we would like for IP over IB to have the same feature. Again, introduce RSS. So again, an RSS UDQP would be allowed to connect to an indirection table and not just the raw Ethernet QP. The UDQP itself will manage the transport attributes, the PKI, the QKI checks. And using such a scheme will allow us to actually use a single wire QPN in UDQP. Basically, the QPN, the QP number, is exposed to the network. So in this scheme, we can use a single QPN to approach multiple receive queues. And then we'll continue with the transmit side scaling. So in transmit side scaling, it's the opposite. We use multiple send queues to send to the network. And with IP over IB, we basically, again, because the QP number is exposed to the network, we would like to use a single QPN for all the send queues. So whenever we send, no matter which send queue, we use the same transport object and the same QPN. So we see this approach fitting well and serving well both UDQP for IP over IB and TSS. Next topic is how we would like to support L2 tunneling. So we can see that tunneling technologies like VXLAN, NVGRE, Geneve were introduced to solve cloud and scalability and security challenges. And Nix now added support for stateless offloads for such encapsulated packets, because without supporting them, basically the outer headers are pretty much the same for many connections. So RSS, if we do RSS based on outer headers, we basically hit the same CPU for all connections, since outer headers parameters are the same. Also for checksum, if we are unaware of encapsulation, we basically will not be able to do inner TCP checksum offload. Another example is LSO, LRO, large send offload and large receive offload. Basically, that's the offload of TCP segmentation and desegmentation. Again, we need to be aware of encapsulation in the hardware in order to offload the inner header segment, TCP segmentation and desegmentation. So to support these, already many NICs already added support for such encapsulated packets for the network driver. And we would like to allow this also for verbs. And in order to do that, for checksum, we need to add to QP attributes and to the send work request parameters that ask for checksum generation and checksum check on receive. For TCP segmentation, we need to indicate the inner MSS. For VLAN stripping, we need to add the strip and the insert operations, and also carry the stripped VLAN in some cases into the work completion from the hardware completion queue. We also need to be able to steer packets according to inner headers. We now need to look into inner headers and maybe also the tunneling ID, the VXLAN ID or NVGRE ID, and steer according to that. I mentioned already RSS, and in many cases we have a kind of an offload where we parse the encapsulated or the inner headers, or the, today it's the outer headers, but carry some data from the headers into the completion queue just to save a cache miss whenever there's need to be a decision according to some kind of header attributes. So we might need to copy some header information from the inner headers into the completion queue. Okay, so that was about tunneling. Regarding capturing, today users, administrators can enjoy capturing facilities for network traffic, for TCP traffic, uses TCP dump or Wireshark. We would like to offer same tools for users that use user mode Ethernet programming. So basically, we've added to the standard tools whenever a leap pickup is spawned or a TCP dump is spawned, and the application that is sniffing uses a PF packet with raw socket. We basically basically send the command to the hardware to also allow duplication and sniffing of OS bypass traffic. In this context, we are talking about user mode Ethernet, but it also valid for RDMA traffic as well. So by allowing that, basically you can use standard tools, same way as you use today, TCP dump, Wireshark, to capture OS bypass traffic. We support, of course, both ingress and egress traffic. Another nice twist to that is that we also can allow OS bypass sniffing utilities. So you can write your own sniffing utility on top of verbs. We basically created what we call a sniffer flow table within the hardware. So you can imagine that all traffic is being replicated for ingress traffic, and ingress traffic is being replicated to another steering table, the sniffer flow table. If you don't push any rules, create flow-based rules into this table, you don't sniff anything. But if you push rules, you basically can sniff any traffic you'd like. You use the same mechanisms as you do today for steering through the create flow. In this example, you would like to sniff the whole traffic, so of the NIC, so you push in all the layer 2 addressing of the NIC. You mention which directions you would like to sniff, TX, RX, and basically the action would be to send this traffic to a specific QP. And if I combine this with the RSS feature, so basically such a sniffing utility, which already performs OS bypass, can also distribute the load into multiple CPUs through the user mode RSS technology. So you can write your own very fast sniffing utility that can be very scalable. Next subject is the completion queue and how we think we can extend it and how we would like to propose extending it. We already did some work on the open source community and submitted some proposals. And the last status of the proposal is that what I'll show here, but a few words about the motivation. So as we've seen, for instance, from the tunneling slide, or now we also talk about checksum, about timestamp, it seems like we need to expand more and more the completion queue. As I shown, if we need to indicate the stripped VLAN in the completion queue, if we need to indicate the checksum or RSS hash result in the completion queue, or any tunneling header information or timestamp, it seems like we need to expand more and more the completion queue. And as we know, the completion queue is basically the receive operation. It's a very critical data path operation. So growing what we have today, the IBV work completion size, would introduce a performance hit. if we'll grow this struct beyond a single cache line, today it's 40 byte. If we'll grow beyond 64 byte, we can introduce increased cache line misses. And also we are introducing on data path more extra copies because basically we copy this data from the hardware completion into the verbs completion, the IBVWC. So it seems like the approach of having a single completion object for all use cases, for all operations, for RDMA, for user mode Ethernet is obsolete. So our requirements from the new object or the new scheme would be to allow reading the attributes that are relevant to the application, allow per vendor optimizations, so each vendor can push his own callbacks and his own code, how he chooses to extract this information into the software raw completion, and also to allow a batch read of multiple completions. If we approach the completion queue and we see that there's lots of completions, and typically such an operation involves updating the hardware where we are at from software perspective, reading the completion queue, it would be much better if we can read a batch, process it, and update the hardware once the batch is processed. So basically the proposal is to extend IBVC queue so it can expose a more object-oriented approach of having callbacks of manipulating and accessing the completion. So we can see here the proposal. Mainly what we suggest is that we'll export those new three methods, the begin polling the completion queue, advancing it with the next method, and the end method. So if I look here, so I can see here that basically begin grabs the CQU lock. Advanced CQU is basically advanced the read pointer of the completion queue entries, and end is basically updating the provider where I'm at. Basically, typically it's updating the hardware with the software read pointer. Also, we export methods for reaching out into the completion attributes. Those callbacks are written by the provider. Each provider can write its own. If we can see that there are common attributes that we need to read, we can present a single method that fetches multiple attributes, like the opcode or the status of the completion. And other fields, like the timestamp, can be read upon request only on need. So this way, we don't have a very giant completion queue work completion element. Last topic, I'll go over it very quickly because I'm running out of time. So basically, as we know today, only privileged users can access the raw QP, as I mentioned in the introduction. We would like to stay supporting raw QP and NetCap raw privileged user that can send whatever headers he wants. But we also want to allow applications that don't care for those headers. It only needs to handle TCP or UDP traffic. So we would like to allow those applications to run seamlessly without special admin privileges. So we have two proposals here. You can read them offline. Basically, it relies on hardware capabilities of enforcing layer 2, layer 3, and layer 4 header attributes, along with working with the TCP or UDP stack, grabbing the ports as being done with the trivial sockets. So to conclude, we can see here that Verbs API infrastructure is very robust and efficient APIs. There are generic objects like the IBVQP and CQ and MR that can be reused for all what we need here. So this is very convenient. Also, the way verbs work, where the control path is slow, it can pass through the kernel and can enjoy kernel services, and data path can either go through kernel if needed, but for critical and high performance data path, typically you would do only user mode, so verbs allow you to do that. And using the verbs extension scheme that was introduced a few years ago, we can backward and forward support older and newer application, which is very convenient. So we see it as a great platform to expand also Ethernet, current existing Ethernet programming APIs. That's it. Questions?
The notion of a combined send and receive queue constituting a thing called a queue pair is something that arose through lengthy, put it mildly, discussions at the time that the InfiniBand architecture was created. That went around and around and around and back and forth a lot. It was not a trivial decision that was reached to combine those two into a single queue pair and then present that abstraction. And it impacted the way that queue pairs relate to completion queues and ripples throughout the entire architecture. It is fundamentally a bedrock notion of the InfiniBand architecture. Have you taken this notion of splitting receive queues and send queues into separate queues to the InfiniBand Trade Association, and have you proposed amending the InfiniBand architecture to account for it? That's one question.
So this is user mode Ethernet. It's already an infrastructure that exists today. It's not something that I invented. You already have raw Ethernet QP type in the verbs today. So I'm trying to understand what approvals do you seek for existing support?
So that's my second question. Raw Ethernet support as defined in InfiniBand today is exactly that. It is not a verbs construct. There are no queue pairs associated with it. It's a port to allow somebody to access a wire using raw Ethernet mechanisms. You're trying to impress on top of that a whole queue pair structure and a verb structure and then convince me that it's actually just raw Ethernet, which it's not.
But
it sounds to me
support.
Like a pretty fundamental
but
rewrite of the architecture.
Support. There is a create flow verb already today. Users use it. We have many customers that use it. So you are reverting to something that was adopted like 3-4 years ago?
So I guess my comment I'm going to summarize is it feels to me like this is a pretty major overhaul of the InfiniBand architecture, kind of soup to nuts. And just personally, I don't have a dog in this fight. My company uses InfiniBand off the shelf. We're fine with that. But from a personal perspective, having participated in the development of the InfiniBand architecture, I think this makes me extremely nervous and should be thought about very, very carefully.
So I can tell you, you don't need to be nervous. This is evolution. This is enhancing the API. You can still use the same terms that you use today for InfiniBand, but you can enjoy more capabilities with familiar objects, with all the documentation, all the infrastructure that in place with training of Verbs API. Users are already familiar with those APIs and those objects for several years now. So I think it's a great infrastructure to expand and not limit it because, I don't know, you need some kind of an approval from.
Again, I think the idea that it's just evolution is a little bit disingenuous. Let me finish my comment. A lot of thought went into the development of the InfiniBand architecture by a lot of companies. There were a large number of companies over the course of 3 or 4 years that developed the architecture and thought hard about this. To see this kind of evolutionary development kind of get slipped in, again, I'm going to say no more, makes me personally very, very nervous. Again, my company doesn't have a dog in this fight, not that interested, but I wonder about it.
Okay, fair enough. Just to complete my answer on your first comment, so there already today a Shrek object which extracts the receive queue from the QP, so we only extend that.
And Shrek was created through amendment to the InfiniBand architecture.
I understand, but I'm saying it's the same way of thought. We can take it to IBTA if that's what you need, but I'm saying that those same architecture ideas are implied here. It's not something completely out of the blue.
I want to make two observations on this. The first is that we're not talking about InfiniBand. Raw Ethernet QPs have nothing to do with the IBTA raw ether type QP. This is just another thing that's another technology that's supported by the RDMA stack, like IWARP or the Cisco USENIC for the matter. So that's one thing. It has nothing to do with InfiniBand. So I think just relevant. The other observation is that InfiniBand does have a notion of queues that are unidirectional, and this is XRC. You have an XRC initiator QP and an XRC target, and they're unidirectional, exactly like the notion of the Ethernet receives and send queues. So even that actually exists in the IBTA, but again, this session specifically has nothing to do with InfiniBand. It's just how you use the OFED infrastructure, the OFA infrastructure to expose user space access to hardware queues, in this case, Ethernet queues. That's it.
Also, I would like to introduce in this opportunity that we have a very active working group, the OFV working group, led by Liran, where we discuss those amendments and changes, get lots of thoughts. So you are very welcome to participate and share your thoughts there.
I should also interject that the these particular patches we're discussing were submitted to the kernel list a couple of years ago using a different scheme that sort of did try not to create these simplex queue pairs, and it was horribly ugly. And it was more or less rejected during review that this was inappropriate. And I think that's what pushed it down the simplex path. So it did have a chance to get industry consensus on at least the Linux kernel list. And this is the result that we're seeing. It might have even been my comment.
Thank you. I have a question. Do you want to comment on the thing?
Just a couple of quick questions. You mentioned you have a DPDK provider that runs on this. Is that available?
Yes.
Okay.
Contact me after.
Okay, very good. The discussion of RSS and the IP over IB changes, does that impact InfiniBand-based UDQ pairs as well? Or is that just for Ethernet queue pairs for IP over IB? I guess I didn't understand.
So you can still use
Use the microphone.
Yeah, you can use the standard UDQP as you like. Whenever you use the UDQP for IP over IB purposes, we will allow you to create, to associate such a QP within direction table and enjoy RSS functionality as you do for Ethernet. But on the wire, it's the same protocol. We can interoperate with a non-RSS IP over IB UD stack, if that's what the question is.
So the changes don't impact, if I'm using UDQPs in an InfiniBand context,
relation to IP over IB?
I'm sorry?
With no relation to IP over IB?
Without any relation to IP over IB, okay.
So that's doesn't totally apply, separate. Because we do use the layer 3, layer 4 headers for doing the hash, so it has to be an IP-based traffic.
Okay, thank you.
Probably a dumb question. When we deploy the raw Ethernet queue pairs along with OS, how does the broadcast and ARP packets and all of that works? Do we have to set a specific filters for broadcast?
Yes, so it's something that already exists today. It's not something new. So we have the IBV create flow verb call. So you can basically push in whatever layer 2, layer 3, layer 4 attributes you'd like. So if you'd like to catch broadcast traffic, just push FF as the destination MAC in the classification of the flow.
So it's replicated to OS and to the user mode both, right? Just like a capture thing.
Yes, the broadcast traffic, yes.
Okay.
But there's also the option that you can just hijack this traffic from the network out. So this is another option that you can do.
Thanks.
Welcome.